So today we want to talk about, first of all, why the difference? You know, over the years, I've helped many churches run Alpha. And as I said, how many of you know what is Alpha, by the way? Okay, heard about Alpha, okay? All right. I'll give you more detail later on for those who don't know what it's about. It's just an evangelism course. But it's more than just an evangelistic course. So I've been involved over the years helping churches. And when I help a church, I don't just train and run. I'll stay with the church, and I actually sit through all the course, usually the first two or three courses, and then debrief them. And I noticed that those churches who had the benefit of coaching, they all have grown. You know, some have more than doubled already since the last time. Like Bethesda, Bedok, Tampines Church. I'm not saying they grow just because of Alpha, but Alpha became the catalyst. And, you know, when I first started then, they had about 700 people. Now they're 1,000, probably coming to 2,000. And then, of course, some are smaller churches like Kamiang Methodist. You know, when I was there, they have about 180. Now they're hitting 300 and more. Huh? All right, every year they run Alpha. And some very small churches like Leng Kwang Baptist Church, you know, when I was there, they only about 80 people. But since then, they have hit 200 people. And so, in a sense that some churches grow. So you wonder why, you know. And I'm going to first of all read to you a text from the Bible, Acts chapter 2. All right. And then from there, I want to point out something quite interesting if you have not noticed. Now, most of us are familiar with this passage. Acts chapter 2, verse 42 to 47. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number, some versions say to the church, day by day, those who are being saved. Now, we all are familiar with Rick Warren's five purposes, right? And if you to look at the first, the verse there, it says that, well, first of all, they're teaching, which is like discipleship. Huh? Rick Warren will say that's discipleship. Then they have fellowship. Well, Rick Warren called it fellowship. Then you have breaking of bread. Well, that's worship, right? Because that's the center part of worship. Then you have prayers in plural. Basically, I see that as ministry. With prayer ministry, not just praying to God, but praying for people. But there's one thing that's missing. What is missing? You know Rick Warren's five purposes. What is missing? Hello, are you there? I hope you haven't fallen asleep on me. Okay. What is missing? Evangelism. Have you noticed? It's not mentioned. Why is it that the early church have no evangelism? And yet the church grow. And I always puzzled. I said, where did Rick Warren found evangelism? Let's say in this text. Actually, there is evangelism. And the method is the church. You see, the rest of the verses is evangelistic, if we may put it this way. Or perhaps a better word is, it's missional. All right? Yeah, there you are. Okay, thank you. I must. Where do I see this? I cannot see except them. Okay. Okay, I can see that a bit. Okay, all right. Half me. Maybe you can put the slide there so I don't want to see myself. It's okay. Yeah, okay, thank you. I feel self-conscious seeing myself. Okay, just let me see the slide. Thank you. Now, so the question is, there's no evangelism program, but the church grew. Because in the early church, the self-identity is mission. You see, they don't need a program to tell them to evangelize. They know the church is a missional community. You know? And so therefore, it's something that they do quite unconsciously because that is their self-identity. Now, why aren't we doing the same? Well, before we go on further, don't need to show my face. I want to see the slides. All right, huh? You don't mind, huh? Oh, for recording purpose. Okay, sorry. Okay, I want to see what's going on there. Okay, the next slide, please. You'll find that in the early church, it's very important. I want to study this point. That, you know, the early church is missional. You may wonder, what is missional? What are you talking about? In Acts chapter 6, when the church has its first pastoral crisis, the crisis was about distribution of food to the widows, right? And of course, the apostle immediately realized that the church is being shifted out of focus. And suddenly, the whole attention is about taking care of the pastoral need, you know, of the people. And so immediately, Peter rose up and said, look, it is not good that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick up from among you seven men of good repute, full of the spirit of wisdom, whom we will appoint to do this duty. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Now, when I was a pastor, when I see that, I said, there, okay, great, let's have more prayer meeting. All right, let's have more Bible study class. But the church never grew. So I said, what went wrong? And then after running Alpha, doing Alpha, and looking at all the churches, all the places, the last 16 years, I realized something. That if you read the context of this verse, in verse 7, it says, and the word of God continued to increase, and the number of disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith. In other words, the word ministry is not focused on insiders. It's focused on outsiders. Wow. Somehow I said, is that what you pay the pastor for? In fact, when I first started running Alpha in this Anglican church, there are some people murmuring, you know. Say, now, Pastor Ben, he only interested in outsider. He love outsider, don't love us anymore. Wow. I was wondering what is happening. Okay, because they have this idea that the church is for us. The ministry is for us. That's why we pay you. And so they find it uncomfortable that I spend my whole afternoon Saturday reaching out to the lost. But if you look at the New Testament, the church primarily is focused on seeking and saving the lost. That's why God adds to them. And everything they do, even when they eat, they have lost people among them. That's why they were in favor with all the people, because they were part of it. They are not exclusive, they were inclusive. So their evangelism method is the church. People come and see. Say, that's great, I want to be part of that. But for us, sometimes evangelism is a program we do. Maybe twice a year, Christmas, Easter. Maybe for some more hardworking, once a month. But so it's a program outside the body. And so the church, by and large, is not touched by our evangelism internally. It's not an internal self-identity. The self-identity of the church is still very much pastoral. And I just saw an article recently in the Facebook, someone sent it. Said the main reason why the church is not growing is pastoral care. Oh, that's something quite shocking, right? It said pastoral care drained the energy of the pastor from doing what God called him to do. That's why the church is not growing. And I have gone through that for many years. It drained me out. 90% of my attention is focused on just making people stop complaining. It was taxing, yeah. 10% Saturday night, Saturday afternoon, I was very happy. The happiest moment, no, people notice and say, well, you're happiest on Saturday afternoon, now why? Well, because I'm doing what I believe God called me to do. The rest of the time, my hair grew white. Actually, you can't see it now, I died. My wife told me, my hair grew white within a few years. Few months, oh, I'm serious. Because I became the senior pastor. And all I see is problems, complain. You know, and in fact, it took God's healing. One time I was at a meeting by Tommy Tenney was leading a breakfast meeting. And I was there. And I thought I just want to go and hear him because I read his book, God Chaser. But when he came, he didn't even preach. He just shared. He said, I just came back from, you know, so-and-so place. And suddenly he said, stop. Okay, I think the Holy Spirit is here. And we are all pastors. Most of us are full-time workers. Sit down and what kind of preacher is this? Okay. All right, let's see what the Holy Spirit wants to do. And before I knew it, I was hit by the Holy Spirit. I just wept out my heart. Not just me, but many other pastors in the room were crying out their heart. What was happening? Because God was healing. You know, so pastoral ministry can be quite painful. And after that, I felt I was able to function again normally. Yeah, it's true. For that period of time, my hair get whiter and whiter, like Moses. I was becoming like Moses. But the question is, why did the church stop becoming missional? Now, if you study church history, which was also part of my study, all right, when I was doing my program, is this. If you look at church history, for the first 3 centuries, the church essentially were missional. Now, they believe that the church exists primarily for one purpose, to reach the lost. And it grew and grew and multiplied until it was so successful, it was a victim of its own success. When Emperor Constantine in the 4th century officially said that the Roman Empire will be Christian, that was when it went down. Because they introduced this idea of clergy and laity. And not only that, slowly the focus became not mission, but pastoral care. Because the clergy were all trained to maintain the church. And so, when a missionary comes to Singapore or any part of the world, of course, the initial missionary, they plant the church, they do evangelism, but once the church is established, they transport the whole system to Singapore or whatever country, and it becomes a pastoral paradigm all over again, and they stop, and the church stopped growing. This happened to many denominations. So, where does Alpha come in? Well, Alpha, I realized over the years, have begun to do something to some church. It has turned them inside out. From inside focus, many churches become outside focused. Now, some churches resist it, and that's why Alpha didn't work, because they're too much inward looking. I remember I went to one Methodist church, not Wesley Methodist. Wesley Methodist is doing Alpha. But this church, they asked me to present Alpha, and they said, well, okay, you only have 10 minutes. It's a leaders meeting, cell leader meeting after service. Well, I said, 10 minutes, what can you say? Okay, never mind, I try. You know, so I get all my PowerPoint ready, and in 10 minutes, I tell them what is Alpha. Then when the leader heard it, after that, the lead, cell leader coordinator came up. I thought he's going to, you know, reinforce the message. Yes, let's do Alpha. Instead, the moment he came out, he said, hey, don't forget, the rally yourself people come for the bowling. Totally forgot about what I shared. I sat down and said, oh, I'm a fool. Come to all the way here for 10 minutes, and the next thing that happened is bowling. It's all about taking care of the people inside. Ministry is called pastoral care. So churches have become insider-focused. So that is the main problem we face. And thankfully, Alpha have forced churches to turn inside out. I'm currently attached myself. I move around quite often to church, among churches because of Alpha. So now I'm currently attached to Queenstown Lutheran Church. Used to be member for a period, then I left to go around the world and came back, okay, to Lutheran Church. But I've been with them for the last 2.5 years because they want me to help them do Alpha. And initially, they were resistant. All right. But thankfully, the leadership hang on, bite the bullet. Some people left, but they did Alpha. And now they've seen that the last few years, 50 baptism, you know. And so they can see visible growth. You know, they are getting excited. And also, they are on a building program. So at first, some people say, why do you want to build? No newcomer coming. But now they see that as they build, the new people are coming in through Alpha. Now, I'm not trying to exalt Alpha. It's not Alpha. Alpha is just a tool God used to kind of pry open the church to change mindset. And even for this church, it's not 100% turn around. But slowly, you know, through some of the people and the new people coming in, the paradigm is shifting. It takes a while, all right? And when we can do it successfully, the church will have its own momentum to grow. Now, in order to understand how Alpha can help our church, all right, to grow, first of all, you must understand Alpha, where it comes from. Okay? Now, Alpha's root, that's too fast. Now, Alpha started in this church in London called Holy Trinity Brompton. All right? And in this church, the senior pastor or the vicar, we call in Anglican, we call him a vicar, not some kind of car, okay? Sorry. It's a vicar, okay? Not vicar. All right. But anyway, it's a vicar. He is a church planter because he has written some books on church planting, which I read before. All right. And not only that, he experienced the Holy Spirit, and so he was very passionate for change. Now, this is a very traditional church. Here you see, like, it's very modern, but actually, you look at the building, it's actually a traditional Anglican church. And the first thing he did was he talked about the church identity. It's not pastoral, it changed the whole mindset. And the first thing he did was he sacked the choir. You know, in those days, they're paid choir. Just come here and sing, all right? They're not full-time worker, they're full-time singer, okay? They don't work, they just sing, all right? And then after that, he threw away all the pew, and he has to resist all this infighting. He removed pew. He said pews are a hindrance to the gospel because he needs chairs, all right? So that the whole hall can be flexible. And so he introduced changes because his mind is focused on outsiders. He's focused on outsiders. And so Alpha was initially just a membership class, okay? All churches have membership class. But because of him, the whole church environment began to change, and the Holy Spirit also visited the church. All right, there was a kind of revival that happened. And out of that, when the main speaker, Nicky Gumbel, came along full-time on this church, he was a church member, right? So he became a full-time worker. And then he tweaked the membership course, and it became a missional course. Nothing very much have changed. They invite people, you know, and the church started to grow. And other churches heard about it. Hey, how did you win people to Christ just by attending this course? And then he began to organize his first conference in 1990, explained to everyone who wanted to find out about Alpha. And so it exploded. And now there are 29 million people attended Alpha in 169 countries and in 112 languages. Now, if you listen to their testimony, they say, we didn't promote Alpha. We never promote Alpha. It's people who call and say, what is this Alpha? Tell us. It's the Holy Spirit who push it out to the whole world because we need it. And it's transformed many churches from being pastoral focus, insider focus, to outside focus. And Alpha had done that. Now, the reason why some churches cannot grow is because they refuse to change. And that's why it died in some churches. But those churches I have been helping, they always have pastors who say, let's do it. Let's focus outward. And they reap the benefit of this tool. See, Alpha is just a tool. You can throw it and call it beta, whatever you want, okay? Doesn't matter. It just so happened at this time, God used Alpha to change mindset. And once the mindset is changed, I just Leng Kwang Baptist Church, the pastor, I said, how did the church grow so fast? He said, it's not just Alpha. See, what Alpha did was to make our church seeker-friendly. You know, now people start inviting friends, non-Christian, to church without Alpha. See, it changed a certain paradigm. They know now the church is not about me and our needs, but it's about a missional community. And so it become a habit. And so a church can grow with and without Alpha. And I just want to share one particular story. Let's have the next slide. You know, Holy Trinity Brompton planted a church plant in KL about 3 years ago. You know, and that is a picture of it. And it started with 50 people. They always send their best, the pastor from UK and the worship team, and then plus a local, 50 of them. Within a few years, they grew to 700. And they just run Alpha, they said, 3 times a year. Because the soil was right. You see, Alpha is like a plant. It's been planted in this church, Holy Trinity Brompton, a missional church. When you take it out and plant in another church, the soil must be the same. If not, the plant will die. And the soil that make Alpha succeed is a missional soil. So that's why I want to share with you today. All right, this is very important. Maybe you have tried Alpha before. I understand you have tried before. but it's not producing much fruit. But when you think that the church is the method, then it involves all of us. It's not a program. As I say in the New Testament, there's no evangelism method or program because the church is the evangelism too. People come in, they're invited, you know, and they saw them and they experienced the power of God, the presence of God, and they say, hey, there's something here. You know, currently we are in the midst of this church. This is the fifth run. We have non-Christian in our midst, you know. The group that I'm facilitating, we have two Russians, four PhD students. One is a Buddhist, you know. And they come. They say, why? What keep them coming? They are curious. They look at you and me. They say, what is this? It's not just the message they are concerned about. The gospel is you and me. And they experience that sense of fellowship, you know, and they want to know what's this all about. So if Alpha is to succeed, I understand from your pastor that you're going to relaunch again. That's great. The thing that must change is not the Alpha course. It is the mindset here. You have to reconsider, what is my self-identity as a church? Is this church all about me, insider, or is it for outsider? Once you decided that this church exists for God to reach out to the lost, well, I would say more than half the battle is won. Alpha is just a tool, all right? Nothing very great. It can fail, but it can also succeed. So then, bring me back to the next question. What in the world is Alpha? Okay, this one I'm going to do it very quickly for some of you who don't know what it's all about. But before I talk about Alpha, I want to talk about the three models of evangelism that we are familiar with and where Alpha fit. All right, next slide. Okay, so the three P's of evangelism, I call it. The first one is, first P is public evangelism. All right. And in this case, you know, the target is the masses. Then we invite a very well-known speaker. All right. I call that the focus is this celebrity speaker. It can be Rahab Bonke, Billy Graham, and even Reverend Francis Koo. Okay, right? And you publicize it and people say, wow, I heard his name. I want to come and hear. So that's everything rise and fall on this speaker. The rest of us just stand by, you know, with our notebook and our forms, okay, to catch the fish. Of course, you pray very hard. But basically, you don't do anything. It's all up to the speaker, you know. And that is what I call the gospel rally approach, the healing crusade. I've tried that before. And the result, well, there's some result, but against assimilation is a problem. People don't stay back. They don't join our church. All right, that's one model. Second model is, second P is personal evangelism. So we go from mass to individual. So this is one-on-one, yeah? The navigator style, the four spiritual law method. I've done that also, evangelism explosion. You go to the street, you know, you train to a speech, you know, you memorize a speech, and then you go there and download to that person. The focus is what? The content. You memorize the gospel as a content, either printed or memorized. So you just download. Yeah? Whether the person wants to hear or not, you hope you finish it first. Then after they say, how? You want to accept Christ? And then maybe the person feel that, oh, yeah, maybe that's the only way to get rid of you. Okay, all right. Okay, I say a prayer. Then after, yeah, can I have a phone number? Okay, give you a number. Call up. Okay. No such person. So assimilation also very weak. I know one Myanmar pastor who came to Singapore and heard about Alpha. And her husband is actually a coordinator for EE, Evangelism Explosion in Myanmar. And the wife had always said, we reach out to so many. How many end up in our church? Less than 10%. But when they heard about Alpha, they realized that hey, this is perhaps the tool that we need. So what is the difference then? Well, Alpha is what I call process, what theologians call process evangelism. Next one. So the target is groups, and the evangelism also groups. It's group to group, all right, many to many. And the focus is the context. as I mentioned, people come not just to hear, they come and see. What they want to see? You. That's very frightening, right? They come and see you. They want to see whether it's real or not. And the body life, thankfully, I can tell you this, thankfully, if you are a genuine born-again believer, there are a lot to show. We are by nature, when we begin to move in that area, the Holy Spirit gives us special grace. Okay, let me give you an example. When I was thinking of going to prison, actually I was frightened. And those people who follow me are all retirees. They're also frightened. They say, hey, well, if we're going, will we get kidnapped or not? How to escape? I always said, don't worry, I'll go there. If they kidnap us, I said, I'm a pastor, give me discount, please. But then surprisingly, the first prison we stepped in, you know, that was in Kaki Bukit. It's a reformatory school, you know, boys' school. All right. Well, we felt so welcomed by them, you know. And not only that, there was a special grace we begin to love them. And that is only the nicer people, the nicer one. The one at Kaki Bukit are the better behaving. Then later we expanded and God led us to the more hardcore prisoner. You know, Tanah Merah prison, Changi prison, where, you know, there's no place to sit except on the floor. And we also lock up like prisoners. You know, the prisoner lock us up, so that in case they run, we also cannot run. So you always think, what happened? Well, one day you're going to get it. Okay? And sometimes you'll stand down there and say, hey, we're over, please come and rescue us. So, but again, we found that, hey, we could love these people. We thought we'd be frightened of them. Yeah, first day when we meet them, we're always frightened. They look very frightening. You know, because they are really angry people. But then as the Holy Spirit begin to work in their heart, we begin to feel that, hey, there's a compassion for them. Where does it come from? And one of the retirees who told me at first that they're scared to go in, said, now, you know, prison ministry is very addictive. I said, what do you mean by addictive? Because there's this, you know, this kind of like overjoy when you come out. Say, that one is addictive after you serve them. Because the Holy Spirit follow you in. See, the thing is that God give us the Holy Spirit. It's not for us to watch television at home or Korean soap opera. Yeah. God give us the Holy Spirit so that we can reach out to the lost soul and touch them and pray for them. Then you find that the more the Holy Spirit present, the more joy we experience. Otherwise, why do you need the Holy Spirit? We don't need. We need the Holy Spirit to go on vacation. We don't need. But when you are in the job of evangelism, the Holy Spirit present is strong. You know, and you constantly see miracle of transformation. And that also builds your faith. All right? So there are three kinds of evangelism. So this is called process. This place here, of course, is where I'm serving now. It's just a part of the picture. All right, okay, let's move on. So Alpha basically is a 15-topic, all right, practical introduction to a Christian faith. It's done over 10 weeks, all right, for those who don't know. And at the 6th week, there is a weekend away where you go somewhere. And the weekend away topic is on the work of the Holy Spirit. And that's when we pray for them to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And that's very important because right from the beginning, they experience God. So they come and see, come and hear, come and eat. And finally, they touch God. That's how they are converted. It's a process. So, and we call that the DVD of Alpha. Dinner, video, discussion. And it is done, so this is like outline for those of you who are not familiar, how Alpha is run. It's not just a few weeks, unfortunately, it's 10 weeks. But some people say, why take so long? You see, we are talking about introducing them, assimilating them into a community. And it takes that long for people to get used to the church, or get to know you. So we cannot hurry the process. The person may say the sinner's prayer right from day one, but that doesn't mean that he wants to stay in your church. Unless he experienced friendship, he experienced you, he like you. Someone said that people go to church for all kinds of reasons, but they only stay for one reason, they have found friends. And Alpha provide that friendship, usually in one group, there may be 8 or 9 or 10. So enough for them, they'll stay on because, hey, I got friends here, I want to be here. So that's how it ends. And normally you start with an intro event, which is like a big bang. Anyone, just invite anyone for the one-time event. And then after that, they'll sign up for the course. So usually, if you invite, let's say there are 100 of you here, then you say, okay, well, let's invite one each. So you have 100 guests. And then at a typical intro event, 50% will sign up. Okay, so you have 50 to start off. And out of the 50, they'll sign up. They come for week 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, until week 10. Then, of course, at the end, they celebrate. Okay? And then they invite their friends who are non-believers to come. And so it rolls. How far is a rolling program? It mustn't be just try one first, see how it works. Nikki Gumbel, who is kind of like the main face of Alpha, said this. If you want to try Alpha, don't evaluate until you've completed 9 times. Now, why 9 times? Because in Holy Trinity Brompton, they run 3 times a year, all right? Which means that 3 years. Why it takes so long to evaluate Alpha? Because it takes so long to see the long-term effect of Alpha. You know, many of these Alpha guests, when they come, they accepted Christ. The next round, they want to come back and help. Okay, that is second course. Then the next round, they come. So second time, they are new Christian. Like some now currently, the new course, many of them are just first-time Christian. They're helping in leading worship. You know, they're helping in all kinds of ways. But we don't put them on the leadership level, but we let them help. But we hope that they'll come back again one more time. The next time they come, they become L2, we call it second leader. If they come back again, one day they become the leader. And so it goes. And it's a kind of leadership development. And if you do it long enough, in 3 years you can see many of these once upon a time non-Christian, within 3 years, become leaders of your church. That's why then you can evaluate the effectiveness of Alpha. Because you see not just converts, you see disciples, you see leaders, disciple maker. All right? So there are some things about Alpha that must be in place before it works. And we call that the Alpha ethos. Okay? I call that 4R. The first R is relational. Alpha is relational. All right? Let's have the first R. Just press. Okay, first R, relational. In other words, it's all about relationship. So one of the things that many church people find difficult is relating to non-Christian. In the office, they also don't relate to them. They eat lunch all by themselves, right? Okay. And then, wow, now you're non-Christian right in your midst. They either overreact. You know, some will become super spiritual and start to convert them on day one and turn them off. Okay? So we teach people, relax. Focus on helping them to belong before they believe. We always feel that, yeah, they are non-Christian, worldly, you know, don't touch them. No, we say, no, embrace them first. Hug them first. Belonging before believing. If you don't love them, they will not believe you. For us, we do it the other way. If you're not a believer, please give an arm length. Until you believe, then I hug you, brother and sister in Christ. But if you're sinners, stay far away. But in Alpha, it says belonging first. If they cannot belong, you don't feel that you're a friend, they'll not believe what you say. So that's the first one. Second ethos that must be there is must be real. We always say, no lingo of Zion. You know, in our Alpha context, you see, we are trying to make the church friendly to the world. So we don't come around and say, hallelujah, amen, brother, you know, we say, brother. Use this kind of language, you know, and then frighten the non-Christian. What are you doing? Wow, this morning I was washed by the blood of Jesus. Wow, they say, you take bath with blood, you know. I said, no, I don't want to come. You know, already chicken blood, I'm scared now. Blood of the lamb. So a lot of this religious lingo frightened non-Christian. You may find it very funny, but actually it is. I said, what is this language you're talking? It's not English. Okay? So we try to tell the people, look, use normal English you talk in the office. Okay? All right, be real. Don't suddenly come to church and act holy. Because they also feel uncomfortable. But they want to see that you are real. Same as what they see in the office, but maybe better than others. All right? So third R is relevant. So we encourage our helper, you don't need to know theology. You know, it's good to study theology. I studied that, okay? So it's good to have a Bible school. But I'm saying that some of you are scared of being involved in evangelism because I don't know the Bible, don't it? All you need to tell is like the blind man. Before that, I cannot see. Now I can see. Who cannot do that, right? So you encourage them. Just give testimony. In fact, that is more, better than all the theological stuff you know. In fact, that confused them. Just said, well, I prayed and God answered me. Before that, I was a drug addict. Now I'm free. All right. Before that, I smoked. In fact, in our Alpha course, these four runs, so many smokers dropped the habit without us even knowing. All right. So one by one, they stopped to change. They start to change. And people observe. Their friends say, hey, what happened to you? Oh, it's Alpha. You know, come on, come and see. So people want to hear your story. They don't want theology. Not that they don't need it. Not yet. A non-Christian want to hear that God is real in your life. And the last R is relax. You know, I mean, don't be so tense up. I remember last time, you know, when we do evangelism, we are counselor, we are always very tense. You know, we'll stand one corner, praying very hard and very cold, you know, because the non-Christian coming forward. Yeah. But how far we relax, you know, you see, that's why they all have this. These are, by the way, this two are non-Christian before that. And now they're helping Alpha. Okay, the last round. This round they didn't help because they're busy. But they're new converts. And then they enjoy themselves. You know? And so, there'll be people like that coming to your church. And they're going to stay. In fact, they're still around. Many of these Alpha converts stay in church. They don't disappear after they accept Christ. So I'm going to now just share very quickly four New Testament principles behind Alpha. Now they've seen more. What is Alpha? What is the principle behind? Why do you do all these things? Okay, let me just try to go through very quickly the four principles. I'm given 1 hour so I can afford to take a bit longer than the normal sermon I preach. Usually in a church, anything beyond 30 minutes already, people start to look at their watch. I'm told here you can go up to 1 hour. Am I correct? Okay, but don't worry, it's interesting. That story, I have a lot of story, but I'll try to watch my time. Okay? Okay, the New Testament principle behind Alpha. First of all, the first principle is this. Evangelism is most effective through the local church. That's why I said, just now when I was praying about this, I said, what should I say about the church in the New Testament? About evangelism? What's the method they use? And I believe the Holy Spirit said, it's the church. The church is the method. We have forgotten. Jesus said, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, that you love one another. And when they come here, they see, wow, you serve them. You take care of them. And then see how you treat each other. I remember one Alpha convert. He's 50 years old when he came on Alpha. That's in Kamnyang Methodist Church. And he's a Taoist. Or he was a Taoist. You know? And then he came first day. And he constantly asked, any of you have seen God? You know, quite challenging. Some of the questions they ask. Any of you have seen God? Because he has seen his, right? It's all in the temple. So they want to know what kind of God we see. We don't know how to answer. You know, Bible says, see God, you're already dead. When I die, I'll see. And so we have to think of ways to answer this kind of funny question they ask. But anyway, to cut a long story short, at the 6th week, he accepted Christ because God revealed himself to him. So he saw God, not physically, but as a blinding light. And he accepted Christ. And then he shared later on at the end of the course his testimony. He said the reason why he came on Alpha and stayed on is because he saw the way husband and wife treat each other, Christian couples. He said, wow, if that's the way Christians treat one another, I want to stay on. And later on we found out why. Because he and the wife, communication has broken down completely. They cannot talk anymore. Remember he says that, you know, every time the wife calls him when he's driving, you get so angry, you throw the phone out the window. I say, threw away at least 4 or 5 phones. So I say, next time before you throw, tell me, Okay, I go and pick it up. But after that 6 week at a retreat, that night he called the wife and talked to him in a different tone. You know, and that is what it's all about. All right? But what make him want to stay on is not the Nicky Gumbel talk or whatever talk. We use live talk in those days. But it's what he saw. All right? So it's the most effective tool. You and me are the tool of evangelism. It's not a program. Alpha is not a program, basically. Alpha is very straightforward. They just make you do what you ought to do. Okay? So why? In fact, in the Bible, Paul says the Lord's message rang out. Next slide. The Lord's message rang out from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, has become known everywhere. In other words, the gospel come out of the local church. All right? The message is in the church. Okay? And John Stott said this, evangelism through the local church is the most normal, natural, and productive method of spreading the gospel today. You see? It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. It's not a method. When people look at you, they see Christ. And there's something about the corporate body that is very powerful. Because you can't, a lot of times we emphasize on individual witness in the office, you're a good guy and so on. But it's when Christians love one another. You can't love one another if you are alone. But it's in the local church that they see it. And then they are impressed. And they say, wow, I think there's something there. All right? Because they have not experienced that outside the church. Don't underestimate the power of Christian fellowship. All right? So why is it that the local church is the most effective? There are four reasons. First of all, what you see is what you get. In other words, when they come in, they look at you, they see how you relate, they see, hear the song you sing, you know, and then they look at your place and say, hey, this, you mean this is church? Maybe they expect to see a lot of crosses all over the place. Yeah, there are some. Okay. You know, some churches, you know, have this funny shape. So they come and say, hey, this looks like a social hall. And if they like it, they'll stay. All right? They don't have to make a kind of cross-cultural change, which happened in rally. Rally, you know, different stadium. Oh, all the nights, a fantastic singer. Then come to church, hey, the speaker like that. Well, all the singer like that, okay. So they have a cultural shock. But here, Alpha, after 10 weeks, they like it, they'll stay on. No reason. And not only that, they've seen the pastor for 10 weeks. And I always encourage senior pastor to be around. All right, so I said, oh, you mean that one is the pastor? I didn't know, no? He introduced himself as Francis. Okay. You know, in Alpha, I always tell him, please don't call me by any funny title, okay? I'm just Jimin. And not only that, we used to play this game as Charming Jimin. Okay. So they always know me as Charming Jimin because it's one of the name game we play. So after they realized I'm pastor, huh? I remember one time, you know, this is funny, that's funny. This is a Catholic, she's like Indian. Catholic. So on Saturday, I was like in my CV. Anglican also very high, wear robes and all that. But anyway, on Saturday, I'm in my CV. Wear t-shirt and all that. So I was the leader of the group, you know, discussion. Then she enjoyed. Then 1 week, suddenly said, can I come to your visit your church on Sunday? Sure. And it so happened it was Communion Sunday. And Communion Sunday, we Anglican rope out like the Pope like that. And then he's looking at me. After service, I come, hey, welcome. She goes stunned. What, you mean you're a priest? Next Saturday, she did not talk to me already. She says, they're scared because they have this mind like Chai Kong like that, you know. Do you like to enjoy talking to Chai Kong? No, right? I saw I conduct the funeral after that, please go. Right? So, if they see what they see, they like it. They say, okay, that's great. I'll stay on to this church. Second reason is that it mobilizes a whole army of lay people. See, anyone can be an evangelist. You don't need to be the speaker. You can be a good cook. Like in this current run, some volunteer to cook cake, you know, to add to the menu. Yeah, some just good at serving people. Some just, you know, go there and sing song and lead song and so on. So different people doing the same thing, presenting the gospel. in song, in service, everything. The goal is the same. It is to help this non-believer feel welcome and hear, see, experience. Because all these cook and all that, later on, they will also be trained to pray for people. Every helper can pray for not just the pastor. Every one of them, at the weekend away, they will rush out their hand to their friend and pray. And God works through them too. Yeah? Amen. Okay, next reason is friendship-based. So you see, as I said, people go to church for all kinds of reasons. They can't find friends, they won't stay, no matter how wonderful the speaker is. All right? So this friendship network, keep them on. Okay? And as I said, 10 weeks, they form very strong friendship. And, you know, they start calling each other by nickname and so on. And the last reason is why you should do your local. The more checkout, the more customer. What does it mean? You can do alpha recommended, I think, minimum twice a year. You do it too infrequent, very hard for people to invite to the next course. Ideally, 3 times. So the more you do, the more people come to Christ. Simple. And some people say, okay, I not just want to do adult. How about the youth? Okay, I also do youth alpha. How about senior citizen? Yeah, senior citizen Saturday morning. So there are a lot of checkout counter. And because more checkout, every time there'll be people safe. Don't worry. And so the more you do, the more outlet, the more people come to faith through alpha. Almost guaranteed. You know, last time I always give this guarantee, and I want to give this guarantee by faith to this church. When I did this survey in Kam Yang Methodist, I said, don't worry, I have good news for you. By the end of this year, when you finish your first round or second round alpha, you're going to see many hands put up. First-time Christian, less than 1 year old. And sure enough, it always happened. And I said this to this church too, that this is what will happen. And alpha has a special place. You see, many of us have a harvest event, but we have problem bringing them into church because we don't have a halfway house. I remember one time St. Andrew Community Church in Simi. They are very good in reaching out, you know, a lot of community services, make friends with all the people in the hospital and so on and so forth. But now they don't want to come to church. Then when they discover Alpha, they say, wow, that's great. Alpha is like halfway house, midway. They invite them to Alpha, not to church. And many of them turn out because their food, all right, and Singaporeans all like to eat. So it's like, come, okay? And if your food is good, and we always advertise the menu in our church. Yeah, well, I say, next week, the menu is chicken rice. And then they say, wow, chicken rice, better come. Okay? So they come, and then after that, they become absorbed into the, either they form new CG, or they get absorbed into the existing CG. Then, better still, they come back and help the next run. And so it goes. The missing link in many churches is this halfway. See, that's because the church has become too Christian focused, so that the non-Christian, if they come one time, they either can't sing any song, of course they can't sing, none of them they have learned, maybe Amazing Grace, if you happen to sing Amazing Grace, but they'll stand down there, they won't sing a single song. I remember one time in my church, there was a newcomer brought by the wife a Christian, but her husband not a Christian, and we all very charismatic, Anglican, half an hour all stand. Just like just now. We all go all the way. He forced to stand because everybody's standing. Yeah? Then after that, we follow up, call, hey, how do you enjoy our service? Well, he scolded the person who called him. How can you make me stand for half an hour? I couldn't even sing a single song. You see? But now far, we say, never mind, sit down. Now we tell our church people, lead worship, please don't make them stand. They don't know how to sing. So now we say, let them sit down. If they cannot sing, at least can sit down and relax and listen. All right? So we are trying to teach them to be seeker-friendly. So you find that with Alpha in place, whatever program you do, evangelism, healing service, whatever, the first place you bring them is Alpha. Then they form friends, they form group, and then they become part of your church automatically. Okay? Second principle, very quickly, is evangelism is a process. Now, sometimes we forget. We think that, you know, people get converted within 5 minutes. Those, thankfully, you know, those people who are converted like myself in a rally. I became a Christian when I was in the first year university. I attended a magic show. Not Lawrence Kong. He hasn't existed yet. Okay. It's actually his master, Andrew Cole. You know, Andrew Cole is his tutor. So I was a student, 19 years old, and I listened, you know. And then, of course, the first time I heard the gospel, I believed. But I said, wow, no need process. No, actually, before that, I was reading the Bible already. Before that, I've seen my brother went to church and Christian came to our house to visit. I said, hey, these people look different. How come? I was curious, but I don't know what is it all about. See, so there is a process. But when I reached the university, I really made up my mind. I want to find out what Christianity is all about. And when I heard it, I said, yeah, that's it. I'll give it a try. All right, so there's a process. But more importantly, Alpha capitalized on this. Can we have the next? Because in the Bible, you see that everything you got to do with the spiritual growth is a process. Agriculture, I planted, it's the seed, building, journey, even born again. Jesus said, you shall be born again. How long does it take to born again? Born once. Is it instant? Other mother, you take 9 months to give birth, right? So why do you expect a person to become a Christian instantly? There's a process. Okay, next. In Alpha, we allow the process. You see, nowadays people don't know anything. You see, those evangelism method I believed from the West is because Western society at some point was quite Christianized. All right, so you don't explain too much. That's like the Jewish society. You know, on the day of Pentecost, 3,000 came to faith, right, on a single day. But on the other hand, when Paul preached in Athens, in Acts chapter 17, only a few people come to faith. Is it because Peter more anointed than Paul? Well, I used to think that way. But actually, it's not. Because the Jews are prepared. From young, they've been taught the scripture. So when Peter says it, they connect the dots and say, yeah, that's it. But you go and speak to Athens, people who never heard what Bible, what Jehovah, you know? It's not easy. It takes longer. So we have a lot of non-Christians who know nothing about the Bible. You give them the Bible, you see the way they hold the Bible, very funny. They look at the content page. They say, which chapter are we reading? They can't even find their way around the Bible, okay? So we need to give them time, all right? So see the big picture, first of all. You know, so every week they hear a little bit, a little bit, a little bit. First talk is, who is Jesus? Why did Jesus die? How can I have faith? Blah, 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 until the end. Then they see the big picture, all right? Then they decide. Okay, secondly, it takes time to build trust. When people invite them the first day, they don't know why you want them to come to Alpha. They are suspicious. Okay, maybe they think you want their money, all right? So as they realize that, hey, you're not out to get their money, in fact, you're going to give it to them, you give them food, you give them a lot of things, they say, wow, that's different. So they begin to trust you. Thirdly, all right, they begin to experience church. Now, a lot of time, you know, we have people run Alpha initially, they always say, oh, should we bring them to church? I say, they're already in church, why don't we bring them to church? To them, church means Sunday service. I say, hey, they're already in already, don't tell them. Huh? Okay, every Wednesday they come for Alpha, they're already in church. Now he said, bring them to church, what? See, the concept of church also needs to change. What they mean is bring them to Sunday service. But they're already experiencing church in Alpha. So if they think this is church, why not? Okay, many of them get baptized. So it takes time. So you must give people time. Third principle is evangelism involves the whole person. Again, sometimes we forget that because we have been converted so long ago, we forgot the process involved in our thinking. But people need, especially those who are from a non-Christian background, totally no contact with church, and there are a lot of people like that still. No? All right, they need a process. First of all, they need to be convinced in their mind. Nowadays, I think with the internet, their young people are bombarded with all kinds of ideas, worldviews. And they need to be convinced. All right, point number one. The head need to be convinced. All right? So Alpha provide that. Alpha provide reason, logic, apologetics. It's all built inside. it appeals to the mind. Say, look, it's reasonable. Faith is not a leap in the dark. All right? Secondly, we also appeal to the heart. Okay? You know, this is a postmodern culture, we say. A lot of things, is whether it's, they don't care whether it's true, but whether it's relevant. And say, look, you experience God. You experience love. Especially when they go for the weekend away, they experience God for the first time. And that's count. Because people, it's not just the head people. Many of them are heart people. All right? And thirdly, we must also appeal to our conscience. In fact, in the current course that we are in, there's one Russian, I told you, this lady, who is a pre-believer. When we are talking about sin and all that, they say, actually, sin is relative. They say, you know, you all consider sleeping around as sin. To us, it's not. And she's quite open about that. Sleeping around is not sin. It's just a way of life. Probably she is. She practiced that. I'm not sure, but I never probe further. You know? So they are not convinced. Their conscience is still not enlightened. All right? And so we slowly, through the Holy Spirit, convince them that there's such a thing as sin. And lastly, they need to appeal their will. They need to make a decision for Christ. And many of them take a bit longer. Some take a bit longer. Some will finally yield themselves to Christ. So these four areas need to be appealed, not just the emotion. A lot of people make decisions based on emotion and after regret it. I remember one time, we were at one particular drama called Hellfire, Heaven's Gate or something like that, right? Wow, people get frightened when you see every scene is you die suddenly and you go to hell or heaven. You remember that one? Wow. And my brother, elder brother was there, the whole family. Wow, they were shocked into it. They all just go down. But in the end, I found that he didn't accept Christ. He just followed the crowd. People were shocked into it. But how long is the fruit? I don't know. All right? But people need to be convinced in the mind, in the will, and so on. So Alpha, give people time. We're not in a hurry. Okay? We don't pressure people. The will, we persuade. We don't say, typical evangelism method I learned when I was a pastor is that, you know, tonight, you must accept Christ. You never know, when you walk out here, the car will knock you down. You may not see tomorrow. Accept Christ now, you know. And then we prolong it. Hopefully they made a decision. But people don't believe means don't believe. They don't care. Yeah? All right. But in the case of Alpha, we give them a chance. And finally, the last point is that evangelism requires the Holy Spirit. And that's really the key behind all that. I always tell people, you can't convert anybody. They'll say, huh? Then why you get me involved? Well, we are just facilitator. It's the Holy Spirit that convict and convert. We just make ourselves available. We just be ourselves. Just love people. Provide good meals. All right, let them listen to a talk. Tell some jokes. That's it. And then, wow, so easy. Okay? And then the Holy Spirit begin to work in them. And sometimes some people, even before they accept Christ, they really experience change. Why? Because they go into an environment where the Holy Spirit is, and they begin to be convicted of things that are wrong in their life. One lady actually said, you know, at first I was very hot-tempered. When I came to Alpha, after a few, my temper began to lower. But I haven't accepted Christ. You see? So there's a power in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And we must remember that Holy Spirit is given for that reason. And I'm going to close now because I don't want you to move, just stay there. All right? At the end of the day, it is the Holy Spirit working with the gospel. And we are conduits. And at a day away or weekend away, we lay hand on the people who are non-believers and say, come, Holy Spirit. And then he does the job. Many times the conversion is dramatic, sudden, like this Taoist man who see, you know. And I just want to close with one last story of this young man. I like to tell this story because it's quite interesting. He was invited by his school teacher. He's quite successful, married, you know. And it came out of obligation. Maybe the teacher was kind to him. And so what happened was, each time I was sitting in the group, and then when people talk, he said, you know, actually I'm quite successful. I'm one of the top 5% earner in Singapore. I don't need God. Whoa, very arrogant. But he didn't sound arrogant. He just say as a matter of fact, what do I need God for? I have no need. Okay? So this continued until the 6 week, and I was assigned to him. Probably because they said it's a hard nut. You take okay. So I assigned to him. So I kind of like, okay, so how do you find the course so far? I said, okay lah. I said, okay, do you feel that you want to accept Christ? No, I don't need God. Oh, still the same after 6 weeks. So I didn't know what to do. I said, okay, can I say a prayer, a blessing for you? He's not sure. Okay, no, prayer. Yeah. So I just pray for him. But while I pray for him, I also pray God open his eyes. Huh? Then after that night is a ministry time. We have ministry time after the third talk, how do we feel Holy Spirit? Now, I was not near him. I was somewhere else praying for somebody else. And suddenly I was told he was crying, weeping. So everybody, then of course after that, I was very curious. He said, no need, why is he crying? So we have debrief. All the guys gathered together, debrief. I said, okay. So he was sitting there. I said, okay, what happened to you? Can you share? I was waiting for him to share. Come to his turn. So I said, okay, you know, brother, friend, what's your experience? I heard he was crying. Then he tried to tell and he choked. And he cried again. Unusual. So I said, okay, sorry. Tell us what happened. He said, when they prayed for me, I saw a vision. Oh, non-Christian can see vision. Never mind. Okay. I saw a vision. I said, what do you see? He said, I saw a small boy kneeling there praying. Oh, then I thought, my first thought, maybe last time he was a Christian, kneel down and pray, right? I said, that small boy, is that you? He said, no. Huh? Not you. Then who is it? Said, God, show me, it's my son. Wow. He started to cry again. What? What you mean? Your future son or your present son? I said, okay, then he tried to share. He said, well, I grew up in a family where my mother died very early. And then from young, only my father take care of me. And I missed the family life. You know, my father is very strict. I miss the kind of love in the family. I said, now that I'm married, no children. Yeah, no children. Yeah, try, no children. And so God showed him that he's going to give him a son. Yeah, and he cried. So he said, well, he had no need. Well, he has. The Holy Spirit, no. And that was the turning point for him. See, so we had conversion like that. We didn't do anything. We don't even know what to do for people like that, right? But the Holy Spirit, no. Okay, so that's how alpha conversion takes place. Supernatural, most of the time. We don't have to do much work. So I want to close and encourage you to consider being part of this. All right, it's going to involve your time, definitely. Evangelism is not easy in the sense of time commitment, but someone had to do it. The church is the method. Without the church, no alpha. Is that all right? Let's just pray.